Could they work for the scholars in Vassar Secondary School, business studies, online class. Today we're going to be talking about bookkeeping and source documents. Lesson objectives. At the end of lesson, the student should be able to define bookkeeping, to highlight the importance of bookkeeping, to state the qualities of a bookkeeper, 4. Define source documents, 5. State the uses of source documents, 6. Mention the types of source documents, 7. Explain the types of source documents. 8. Differentiate between credit notes and debit notes. Meaning of bookkeeping. Bookkeeping is a term used to describe recording of cash and credit transactions, so that information relating to the transaction may be easily obtained. When we talk about recording of cash, we're talking about transactions you actually probably you go and buy goods and sell goods, and you pay in cash or they pay you in cash. When you record them, we're talking about recording of cash transactions. When we talk about credit transactions, we're talking about a transaction which you enter into, that is the money transaction, which you pay in a later day, you don't pay immediately. That's why we say transaction is credit. Now, when we talk about bookkeeping, in business studies first step, we have components of bookkeeping. We have components of business studies. We have commerce, office practice, shorthand, keyboarding, bookkeeping too. So bookkeeping is one of the components of business studies. Now we're going to talk about essential qualities of a bookkeeper. 1. He or she must be accurate and careful. 2. He or she must be able to work under pressure. 3. He or she must be good at figures. 4. He or she must write legibly. 5. He or she must be trustworthy. 6. He or she must be able to use the computer. So we're talking about the importance of bookkeeping. Why do you think you should study bookkeeping? Or why is bookkeeping important? Number 1, it helps the businessman to know 1. The value of goods purchased. With the help of bookkeeping, you're able to know that this is the total amount of the goods you've actually gone to buy in the market. 2. It helps the bookkeeper to know the value of goods sold. You'll be able to know that this is the total sales you've incurred today. This is the sales that you've done this week. So that's the importance of bookkeeping. 3. The total expenses incurred by the business. Every business, the main aim of a business, when we discussed business organization, said most of business are formed for profit motive. The main aim is to make profit. So it helps you to know your total expenses. All the expenses you incur, including transportation, carriage, cost of carrying goods to your warehouse, all those costs, total expenses to be incurred. Therefore, the financial position of the business. This will tell you maybe the business is making profit or loss. 2. It is relevant now, so it is relevant to every individual. What we're trying to say is that with bookkeeping, it helps you to be able to balance your expenses with your income. Let's look at today with the issue of coronavirus, you are earning 500 naira or 5,000 naira. Now, with the help of bookkeeping, we said, I've spent 4,000 naira. This is I've spent 4,000 naira. 4,000 total expenses. You have spent 4,000. You're able to question yourself that it's like my expenses are increasing. Why my I'm reducing? My income is not coming. So that's what you have for bookkeeping. You have to balance your expenses with your income. The third one is it is useful to all workers in different professions. no matter the profession you fall in, maybe you're an architect, you're an engineer, or a medical doctor, a banker, you need bookkeeping in your everyday routine. Because as a medical doctor, be able to look at this is the amount I will spend on drugs, this is the amount I will spend on injections, drinks, and all this. This is the amount we spend on this is how much I will pay consultants, like that. So it's very about bookkeeping, be able to calculate your expenses and your income. Now we are going to move to another very important topic, that is source documents. Now, source documents. These are written evidence. They are written evidence of business transactions. When we talk about written evidence, we are trying to talk about the transaction is not orally. Not that, okay, like you go to the market, you buy pepper from the pepper seller, and you bargain. You've done your own transactions. You cannot say that is actually source document. So we're talking about the transaction must be in a written form. So that's why I said these are written evidence of business transactions that describe the essential facts of those transactions. They are original documents in which transactions are being recorded first. The first place you record any entry, any accounting entry, or any bookkeeping entry is being recorded in your source documents. They keep records of transactions and documents, issues to show transaction has taken place. This is where you record such transaction. It's an evidence that this particular transaction has taken place at that particular time. These original documents are being recorded in the books of accounts. Normally, from our source documents, we transfer our transactions to our journals, from our journals to your journals, to your ledger, from your ledger to your trial balance, from your trial balance to the trading profit and loss. So that's how we transfer our business transactions. So now we're going to talk about types of source documents. 1. Invoice. 2. Purchase order. 3. Debit notes. 4. Credit notes. 5. Checks. 6. Receipts. 7. Cash register tips. And 8. Petty cash voucher. Invoice. An invoice is the document used in the business, which gives the complete summary of all transactions. This shows that the summary of transactions that are taking place. Now, the invoice is issued by the seller to the buyer. The seller will issue it to the buyer, showing the quantity. That is quantity of goods which you ordered. So the price discount and the terms of payments. Here we have image of an image of an invoice. Here we have two invoices. On the left hand side, you have an invoice showing the company name Creative Media. Then it's written bill to. So Creative Media is the seller, while the person that will bill to is the buyer. It shows that an invoice number, the dates. So we have the quantity there, the product or the description is there, then the price and the total. Then the other side, the right hand side, you have a blank invoice. It shows you can write your company name, your telephone number, your fax, your email. Then here on the left, under you have the dates, the customer order number, probably from your LPO. We have what we call a local purchase order, where you actually order your goods. So for them to trace it, so you write that, you write the order number there. Then the salesperson will tell us that actually selling the goods, we write his name there, and the terms of payment. You know, when we're talking about bookkeeping, we said recording of cash and credit transaction. So probably you are paying cash, it will be stated there, or maybe you are paying, you pay this and that credit transaction, so actually be stated there. Then the quantity, all that, the description, the price, and the amount, and the signature, which is very, very important. Then we move to uses of an invoice. One, this is the source of information for both sales and purchases. That is, if we gather all of our information for all the sales you've been, all the sales you've made, and all the purchases you've actually incurred during that particular period, especially every day, is done on a daily basis. That is, we call bookkeeping transactions. Two. It shows the complete summary of all transactions. When you talk about complete summary, as we said earlier, it should show the quantity, the details, the transaction details, the terms of payments, if there's going to be discount, the amount, the unit price, everything will be stated on the invoice. Note, an invoice is usually prepared in duplicates by the person selling. Probably, when we're talking about selling duplicates, probably, you have two additional copies. The original copy will be given to the buyer, then the bookkeeper will keep the last copy there. The other first copy might be kept for auditing or just to check for checks and balances purpose. Purchase order. A purchase order may be in the form of a letter, or it may be prepared on a special printed form, which is usually issued by the suppliers. It is the document which describes the document to be bought, the quantity, the delivery date to the purchaser, the unit price of the item, and the address of delivery, if it is different from the purchaser's address. Let's talk about that. This is just a letter form which shows a complete summary of everything you want, that the actual quantity you want to buy, the date of the delivery, the date you're actually going to deliver the goods, the units, the address where you will deliver it. Sometimes you actually, instead of writing the address of the shop, you might be told to go and deliver it to the warehouse or the factory. So everything, or the purchase order will show the address of the delivery. Now moving to debit notes. Debit notes. This is a document written out by the seller whenever the buyer is undercharged, or if the invoice value is too small. When we talk about invoice value, is that actually what is written in the invoice is too small compared to the goods. So you actually give a debit notes. Now, uses of debit notes. One, to correct an undercharged. Two, whenever the invoice is not well priced, then you issue a debit note. A debit note is normally printed in blue. That's why this slide is normally printed in color blue form. Here we have the image of a debit note. How does the debit note look like? Here you have debit notes. The debit note number means that debit note number, your invoice number. Now, your invoice number will be traced because that's where the first transaction was done. So, from the invoice number, they want to trace it to the debit notes. So, here, the name of the company here is Roy & Co. Canal East Road. And the buyer's name is M.S. and Sons. So, that said, with son of 15, this is the reason why the debit note is actually prepared. They said, with some of 15 kg sugar, we receive damage in transit, any of damage in transit, from the seller's place to the buyer's place. Probably the goods actually got damaged, so that is why they're issuing a debit note. At 75 per kg, so what they did, they just multiplied 75 times 15, and they got 525. Then you have the date in which you are preparing the debit note, and the signature of the bookkeeper. we move to credit notes. Credit notes. This is a document sent by the seller to the buyer to collect and overcharge. Unlike debit notes, a debit note is sent by the seller to the buyer to collect on that charge. Why credit notes is overcharged? Maybe people have noticed that your goods are overcharged, you the goods are actually bought, they will now send you a credit note. It occurs because some of the goods are damaged or not as ordered as properly. Probably you actually said that you need 50 cartons of maybe 50 bags of cement. Then that was what was actually in the invoice. Then you just discovered that instead of 50 bags of cement, they gave 20 bags of cement. Then a credit note has to be issued. Using your credit note more to correct and overcharge. So use if the customer has returned damaged goods, it could be as a result of the goods, maybe due to for example, if you actually buy a crate of egg which is a more perishable item or consumable item, then you want to deliver 100 crates. Before you get to where your buyer is, you actually discover that 5 crates were actually broken, then definitely you will be issued a credit note to correct such damage. Here you have an image of a credit note. Normally credit notes is written in either color red or pink. That's why here you see the company's name, the address, the invoice number, that's where the actual transaction was recorded, the date, then to the name of the person, the company, and the reason why the credit note is being prepared to be stated, and the accountant, the bookkeeper's signature, and the likes. Now I want to look at the differences between debit note and credit note. One. The debit note is sent by the seller to collect an undercharge on the invoice price, while credit note is sent by the seller to collect an overcharge on the invoice price. Two, the debit note is printed in blue, while credit note is printed in red color, or it could be in color pink. Debit note is used when the invoice is not well priced. While credit note it is used when the buyer has returned some faulty goods to the seller. Then four, debit note it informs the buyer that his account has been debited. While credit note it is sent by seller when he has said to give the buyer some allowance off. To the buyer, as a result of the damage, we decide to give you an allowance to issue you a credit note. Now we're talking about checks. I'm sure many of us have seen checks from our parents, brothers, uncles, or aunts. They want to discuss what they understand by a check. A check is a written order from an account. When you talk about an account, so that the owner of the account. To pay a specified sum of money, that is the actual amount that you're going to pay the person, whose name is written on the check. What am I trying to say? That, for example, okay, a check can either be crossed or open. Now let's look at this image of a check. Maybe we should explain the definition of check better. We said a check is written. Now you can see we have pay a particular person. This is the Zen Bank and you wrote a manager's check. And this check it has an account number, that's the order of the account, the order of the account as the account to Zen Bank, the date, the specified sum of money is written there, both in words and in figures. Then the signatures to the check to make the check valid, actually signed there, and the account number and the stamp. So you can see this check. This is a simple example of this is a Zen Bank check. So let's look at types of checks. One, we have cross checks, to open checks, we have three other checks, four bearer checks. Note, for this discussion, we'll only be discussing open checks and cross checks. When you get to GS2, you'll be treating banking system, GS2 or GS3, but you'll be treating banking system, then you'll be able to go detail into the banking system, the types of checks, and you'll be able to explain in details. Cross checks. This is a check that has two parallel lines drawn with or without any words. That's, it could be at the left hand corner or the middle of the check. And a cross check is payable only through the collecting bank, that's another bank, and not paid directly at the counter of the bank. What do you mean? Like, if somebody issues a cross check to you, you take it to the bank, they actually pay it into your accounts. You cannot actually collect it from the cashier immediately. The first check will have to be paid and the paid into your account first after some days, maybe like 3 days later, then you actually go and you go to collect the money at the counter. And this is an image of a cross check. This is the first bank check. The date. Now, see, this person is at the center of the check. Yeah, you have the name of the demo pay in Nigeria Limited. The name of the branch is the First Bank Ikeja, Allen Avenue branch. Yes, the sum of money here is 5,725,785.82 naira. So here you have it's written in figures and it's written in words. Then the person authorized the check, the signature is there, and the name of the company here is Platinum Stream Consulting. That's the name of the company's check. That is the first check. So the cashier, you can't collect this check immediately as for you on presentation in the bank. The cashier can't pay you immediately. You have to pay this money to your account, and after like 3 days, then you can go and collect the money. Yeah, we have open check. An open check is which is not crossed. That is a check that is not crossed on the left hand corner or in the middle, and it is payable at the counter of the drawee's bank on presentation of the check. What am I trying to say? That if a check is open, the minute you go to the bank and you actually present it to the cashier, the person will pay you the amount of money written on the check. That check, because that check is actually open, unlike a cross check which has to be paid into your accounts. Yeah, this is an image of an open check. Yeah, you can see the name of the bank, the pay. There is no form of crossing. There is nothing there. Just the account number, the date, the signature, the amount is worth like 10,000 naira. That is the amount that will be paid. The account number, name of the person is written there. This is the open check. Receipts. I'm sure many of us, we have seen one or two examples of receipts. A typical example is our school fees receipts. Now let's look at receipts. A receipt is a document issued to the buyer. You are actually buying something by the seller. It is issued to the buyer by the seller that a sum of money has been paid in respect of goods bought. For example, you actually go to, let's look at, maybe you go to all these big supermarkets. You buy probably 5 cartons of biscuits, you buy sweets, you buy anything. They will actually issue a receipt to show that you actually bought an item. It is issued by the seller to the buyer that you bought a particular item. It is a legal proof of payment and it must be sealed. When you talk about legal, it shows that it is legal. That receipt shows that legal because it has a seal and a stamp to show that that transaction you've done is legal. A good example of a receipt is your school fees receipts. This is the image of a typical receipt. This is a plain receipt. Here you have the receipt number, the date, the person that is receiving the amount of money, the sum of money, from who to the person and by. This is the person that authorized the receipt. So the amount of money is here. And the detail of the transaction will be there. Now let's look at cash register tapes. A cash register tape, what do you understand by cash register tape? I'm sure many of us have seen this all these big machines that they used to record sales in, likes of places like Just Right, all these big supermarkets, big boutiques. Now let's look at cash register tapes. The entries of summary of cash received are being recorded in a book called cash register, divided from the receipt book. So it's these entries that are being recorded because you can't. Let's assume that this is a very big supermarket like Just Right. After attention, we can't be writing orally. Okay, writing manually 5 cartons of the seeds. How many will you write? So with the help of the machine, we have documented all the sales. So what the person will do is 5 cartons of this is the seeds. 5 cartons of the seeds, and it should show. The value of the bookkeeper doing this has been is, as I said, because if you have large volume of sales, you actually reduce the stress and the burden of the bookkeeper with this introduction of cash register machine. Now let's look at the reasons for cash register machines. One, it records the amount of sales and indicates is it a cash or credit sales. Now, because every transaction, we say we have both cash and credit transaction. So the cash register machine will indicate that you actually paid cash. So it records the type of goods sold. Because you have so many goods you are selling, it will tell you that okay, you sold five tins of Milo. That's what the work of the cash register machine will do. Three, it produces a receipt. It is known as cash register tape for customers. Many of us do have this receipt. Another example of this cash register receipt is like the receipt got from the POS machine too. That is a good example of cash register tape. For customers, that's why in the cash register tape, the one that is being stored. The duplicate is stored in the machine box, and while that one will be given to the customer for customer, the one stored in the machine box will be used for bookkeeping purposes. For it indicates the amount of change, if any, is due to the customer. So if the customer's 15 naira change will be indicated in the receipt. Note. Stores with large volume of sales, like I've said, like Testify Chicken, Just Right, Dominion Pizza, Just Right Supermarket, ShopRite, so many supermarkets, even they all make use of this cash register machine. When in school, we don't have the cash register machine, but we have the POS. The POS will show you an example of the cash register receipt, which is being issued. Now, let's look at this image here. We have two images on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side. The one on the left-hand side is showing the cash register receipts. This is an example of the POS receipts. Here you will see Avenue, Main Street, 921 London, this tax number, etc. The receipt number is there. User, what is the person by Coca-Cola? What volume? 100,000, maybe 100,000, total 100. Then on the right hand side, you show the volume. This is the bulk, the volume of the cash register receipts. Now you can look at this. This is the image of is the image of cash register machine. This machine, I'm sure many of you have seen it when you go to big supermarkets like Just Right, ShopRite, and so many others. So actually, this machine, they store all their sales. That's why you see them in front of the cashier. Petty cash voucher. No, let's look at the word petty. What does petty mean? It means something small. Now, a petty cash voucher is usually the small form that is used to document a disbursement. That disbursement is payment. When you're talking about pay, you're paying something, you're disbursing, you're paying. From a petty cash fund. What do you understand by a petty cash fund? Now, let's talk about a petty cash fund. By trying to reduce the burden of the main cashier. Instead of giving the petty cashier to pay everybody money, then you give the petty cashier an impress is an amount given to the petty cashier monthly. Maybe your impress will be, that petty cashier could be 20,000 naira. Every month, the petty cashier must have 20,000 in hand to be able to disburse. So instead of going to meet the main cashier that, please, I want to buy petrol. You know you're going to meet the petty cashier. Please, what's going to buy petrol, 1,000 naira, to issue you a voucher. That voucher we're talking about could be referred to as petty cash receipts. That voucher becomes an evidence to show that a transaction has taken place. That's why in the voucher, she will even write the, why is she issuing the receipt? She writes to buy petrol. You'll be treating petty cash in detail and in the system when you get to GS under the topic petty cash book. And let's look at this petty cash voucher. It shows the date is 14 November 2018. The voucher number is 25. The description, fund issue for office supplies, 15 naira. Then the change that was bought was 14 naira, 52 kobo. And the total there. And it was approved by the manager. The person cannot actually go on his own to go and begin to issue the voucher unless the manager gives approval or consent, and then the petty cashier will actually give you the money. Now we move to cash and credit transaction. I have actually explained this area. Cash transaction is the one in which goods or services are paid for in cash. For example, you come to school, you pay your school fees immediately and give the cashier cash, then the cash transaction has taken place. For example, now you have probably your mom has a shop and she probably goes to meet her customer, probably she goes to midwife she buys are paying in bulk and she tells them that, please sell 10 cartons of soap for me. Sell 20 cartons of drink for me and I'll pay you month end. Then immediately a sale has been made. Whether you pay in cash or credit, a sale has been made. But the difference is that she will pay later. That shows that a credit transaction has taken place. Now let's look at the differences between cash and credit transaction. Cash transaction. One, money is paid immediately, as I said. Money is paid immediately for goods and services. While credit transaction, the receipt or payment of money is postponed for the future. For example, now, if you actually go and buy goods like 50 bags of cement and you pay maybe 50,000 immediately, then a cash transaction has taken place. Then probably you go to maybe your other customer and ask them that, please will sell 20 bags of flour and I'll pay you monthly. Then a credit transaction has taken place because you've actually postponed the payment of money to the future. When you talk about future, it might, so far you did not pay the money that day the transaction occurred, then that transaction is credit. Let me give an example. For example, you are using your mobile phone and you want out of credit. And you know that you need to make a call very, very urgent. What do? You press a code and say,
I want to borrow credits. Then immediately you borrow like 500 naira or 1000 naira. That means you are actually in charge. The next thing they will come to do is remove the money that you are owing immediately. That shows that because you are owing them, so that is a credit transaction. Two, it does not bring room for bad debts. What do you understand by bad debts? Bad debts occurs when you are not sure that the person, the debtor, will pay. For example, imagine you have a particular person owing you 50,000 naira, and you get somebody that informs you that man that owes you 50,000 naira, shop just got born. You will be able to go and meet him that somebody shop just got born with millions, and now I'm meeting that. Come and pay my 50,000 immediately. Then, to you as a bookkeeper, you will consider it as a bad debt. But I'm not saying that he might later pay you. Good. So what you are saying, credit transaction, bad debts may, and I didn't say it is definitely going to arise, it may. Depending on how you control, that's why in some companies they have a credit limit. What do you understand by credit limit? A credit limit is a limitation to your credit. Some could say 30 to 45 days. When you give you credit for 30 to 45 days, means that a month and 15 days. If you fail to pay, then they will come and disturb you that, you have to pay my money. Three, cash transactions is recorded in the cash book. I repeat it again. Cash transaction, not cash. When you talk about cash, you know this is really recorded in the cash book. While the credit transaction is recorded in your purchasing day book, or your general journal, or your sales journal. The next topic we'll be treating will be our journal. Then you'll be able to understand what we're talking about. Purchasing day book, sales day book, your return inwards day book, and your return outwards day book. Now, we're going to practice questions. Question number one, define good bookkeeping. Two, mention four qualities of a bookkeeper. Three, list two importance of a bookkeeper. Four, define source documents. Five, mention several examples of source documents. Six, in a tabular form, list two differences between debit notes and credit notes. Seven, in a tabular form, mention two differences between cash and credit transactions. We have come to the end of this lesson. We are going to like and subscribe to this channel to continue to enjoy more of our videos. You can, in case you have any questions, you can contact us on our WhatsApp number. It is on the screen, and you can contact us on our website on the screen. Thank you, and remember to keep remain. Thank you. Till next class.